God will multiply us. He will increase us. Hallelujah. He has started to increase us. I can see signs. God is increasing us. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm very sure that before the end of the year, we'll have at least 5 new members. I'm saying at least. Now they say, Pastor, you don't have to go to 50 or 500. No, I'm saying for sure at least 5 members. I've already seen some pregnant women in this place. And I've counted them. I've counted them. And I say at least those 5 are sure. Among them, the keys was to increase. Pastor Solomon, I said, people must work hard. And there are many members of this church who are working hard to increase that. Let them be blessed. I bless those fathers who are increasing us. Fathers, be blessed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. It's beautiful to be in the house of God. It's great to be in the presence of the Most High God. This year, God has promised to do what? To increase us. And he said, our year shall be crowned with his goodness. Our year shall be crowned with his goodness. And I told you we're going to testify. Will testify and continue to testify. I'm going to give a testimony before I give the word. This gentleman doesn't know that I was supposed to speak about him. But I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. At the end of the year, I think when I was coming from Cape Town, and after I came out of my fourth leave of 10 days, I was so grateful towards many people, and I mentioned a young man who was sitting there at the back of the media. His name is Percy. His name is Percy. Patrick Percy Cambezo Mafuta. This is his full name. And I was saying that I pray that God blesses him and God shows him his goodness. And he started again seeing the goodness of God. He was away for 4 days from Potchefstroom. He was somewhere in South Africa. He came to visit his family. And then he received a message. It was a WhatsApp message. Now, I don't want to go in too much detail. The gentleman was working and he was using somebody's scooter to do the delivery. And he was paying the money to the company that gave him that scooter. Not gave, that is it lending him the scooter. It was like a contract of used to buy. And at one stage, because of the challenges of COVID, I think the delivery, I don't know, he had some problems and he couldn't be able to pay what he due to the company weekly. The company was very, very grateful to him. They gave him time to sort it out. He tried his best. I remember there were times when he would come. He's not somebody who complains, who cries, but I would see that he's crying in his heart because he wants to do something that he can't. When we could assist him, we did it. Until there was a time when the company said, no, you have to give back the scooter. And the gentleman lost his job. It was end of the year, November, December, there was no more working. And it was tough for me. The year started, and the goodness of God started to be displayed in his life. I'm saying the goodness of God. While he was away, on the third day or the second day, He received a message and he forwarded the message to me. Listen to this message. Dear Pastor Patrick Tambent, and the message starts by congratulations. I told you this year God will congratulate you. Can you give him a hand? The message says, the message says, congratulations. Now listen. Your outstanding amount of about 25,000-21,000 rand has been fully paid. Your outstanding amount of about 21,000 has been fully paid. Now, this boy, yes, that you owe 21,000 rand before. Now that money has been paid. Who is it? He started to ask. He called even my wife to say, Pastor, do you know who has paid this for me? Did you pay this amount for me? And we said, no, we never paid. He doesn't know who paid the amount for me. But he can't send the message to say, your debt has been fully paid. 21,000 rand. When you are crying for 4,000, 40,000 because it is December, now you say it is anyone, there is no money. He has received 21,000 and the planned amount of now listen to this. The message from the company says you can collect your money and transfer the ownership to your name. You can come. Take a bike. Now transfer the ownership. It's no more the company's bike. It becomes yours. Listen this. In 1 week time, we will cancel the current insurance, which is under our name. Should you need it to insure the bike, you must make your own arrangement. But when he arrived, he found that even if the company sent me in, we cancel the insurance. But the company, before they gave him that big bite, they paid the insurance for him for 4 months. Now it's signed on behalf of the company, the boss signs. Now listen to it. If God has done it to person, Patrick Mafuta Kambim, he is also ready to show you his goodness. I don't know what amount you owe, but God is ready to fully pay your debt and you become the owner of something that you never owned before, because the goodness of God shall happen. I pray in Jesus' mighty name that the goodness of God shall never stop in your life. You have started to see, you shall see more. Continue to be faithful. Walk with God, continue to serve Him with all your heart, and the world shall know that you serve the God of peace in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you, boy. I give the hand, give the hand of applause. Give to God the hand of applause. The God of increase, the one who is able to do, the one who can give what you don't get, because His goodness shall never stop. And with all my heart, I will continue to bless this boy. He serves God with all his heart. Every time that I see him, the way he serves God, I say, God, can you give me 100 of persons in this church? It's good that your pastor testifies about you. My heart is open to bless you with all my heart. You know, I just want to release the blessing in my heart. But listen to me. Isaac became old, unable to see, and he wanted to bless his son. Then he called Esau, the firstborn, says, Esau, go out, get me from the sheep. Get me a fat one. And go and cook it for me as I like it. And bring it to me. Let me eat. When my heart will be made, I'll release the blessing of it. People of God, never separate sacrifice from an altar. Never separate anything that because we are under grace, you think that everything falls on you just by chance. No, God looks at what you do. It is important that you commit yourself to serve God with all your heart. When you give, I think in my book, Priorities in Christian Life, when you give to God the first place of your life, make him your priority, God will make you his priority. Hallelujah. I would like to celebrate next Sunday. I want you to be the next on the list. The next Sunday when we celebrate the goodness of God that we take you as a token of appreciation, token of acceptance. This is another example of the goodness of God in this church. I will be the next one. Will you be the next one? Who will be the next one? I say I will be the next one on the list. I will be the next one on the list. That time my heart is so happy to bless Percy that God blesses him. I know I will be the next one to be blessed. We are in the year of increase, the year of enlargement. And God started to speak to us. Since last Sunday, we're talking about enlargement in the Bible, enlargement in the Bible. We're speaking about and looking at what God has promised. And we've seen, number one, that enlargement in the Bible, it is an order from God. It is an order from God. It is an order from God. That's what we see, number one. It is an order from God. And last Sunday, I was talking about the order in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 to verse 28, where the Bible says, God says, he decided, he says, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let us make him. He made him, the Bible says, male and female. Then he decided, he said, something to speak to them. He said, what? Number one, be fruitful. Number two, multiply. Number three, fill up the earth. Number four, subdue it. And then he said, have dominion. I was explaining to you the difference between the three words. When he said, be fruitful, the word in Hebrew is the word para. And para means bring forth, bring forth, bring forth. Let it increase. Add some more. But the next word besides para, he went to Rabba. Rabba now is that multiply. Multiply is increasing in whatever direction. Now you start to get the increase in multiple. And we've seen in the Bible that Isaac, the Bible says he sowed, and in the same year, he reaped in multiple times. The Bible says hundredfold. God wants you not only to increase what you have, to increase who you are, but he wants to multiply. Beside Tara, he wants to grab you, and be behind that, and after behind multiply, he said, replenish the earth, or fill the earth. And the word there, it's mala, M-A-L-A-H. And mala is not more, it's no more only multiply, but it's now make the place full of. Make the place plenty of. Hallelujah. The whole space that is given to you now is filled up. Now you say mala. Then I was saying to these people for this year, we're going to work that we para, we rubber until we mala. Meaning we increase the number, and then we multiply ourselves, and then we fill the place. That is called increase, and that is the plan of God. The thought of God in increasing us is not about only stopping in power, but moving towards rather and reaching matter. Today, I'm going to speak to you in another point in enlargement in the Bible. It's point number two. We speak about it is God's promise. Decide that it is God's order. Decide that it's God's order. Increase is also God's promise. I will really encourage you, people of God, to come to church every drop of every pen, write. It's important to write. Don't tell the drop of the pen. Write with your soul or any kind of electronic device that you have. It's important because these things that I am teaching you, I spend hours. Sometimes you are sleeping. I'm deep in searching the word of God. And don't take it for granted because these are the things that God is communicating to you for your own progress. Hallelujah. Now you will see it easily, but write those things down so that you have time to go and read about them and hear what God wants to tell you because it's important that you have the notes. And look, block notes like this. I have them in numbers, I think in hundreds or almost hundreds. Because since I have even the first one that I started when I received Jesus on 24th April 1994, I started to write this. And I have those books. Hallelujah. It's important to write. And today I can always go back and read what I've written and receive again more. Because it's important. God says to Moses, what I'm telling you, put it in writing. It's important to write. Now, I'll say enlargement is a promise from God. And we see in the Bible, when we go back, because last Sunday I was telling you, when we want to know the thought of God, you go back to the beginning. You go to the beginning, and from the beginning, you will understand the thought of God. In Genesis chapter 12, speaking now about God, increase being God's promise. Go in Genesis chapter 12 and the Bible says, the Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, your people, another version says from your family, and your father's house to where? To the land that I will show you. God says, I will take you to some place. Because increase is about God. The address of your increase, God knows it. He can either reveal it to you, or you can know it by seeking to know the thought of God, the will of God. He says, you will go to the land that I will show you. Now listen to me. Abraham at this time is 75 years old. He is married and he has a wife. His name is Sarai. And Sarai, by that time, she's 65 years old. They never had a child since they've been married. And in their house, Abraham has taken his nephew Lot, who lives with them. Beside the Lot, the nephew, they have in the house also servants. And one of the servants that was very well treated by the family because he's been there with them for long. His name is Eliezer. Now these people, this is the family that Abraham has. God says, take your family, your wife, take your family, go out of this place. Leave your country. I'm not saying that you should leave only the house of your father and go out like you leave your house in middle back here in Pochefrum and you go to stay in Kanana I don't know, in extension 11, but they know God says, leave the house of your father, leave your people here in Portugal, leave your country here in South Africa. I will take you somewhere where I will show you. Now, this is not a judgment of 50 years old or 24 years old. This is not a judgment of this age like us. You are still in your 30s and things are not working in your family, your house. You say, I'm going to look for life somewhere else. I'm going to South Africa, I'm going to America, I'm going to Canada. And you move, not knowing what will happen because you're going out to work and work hard to make a future for yourself. But this is a 75 years old who is already in the dawn of his life, going to count now his years before he goes down. I remember the day I had was celebrating my 40th birthday. I'm happy celebrating my 40th birthday, and I received a call. The call was from my financial advisor, or from my private banker. My private banker was reminding me that it was a day where I was turning 40 years old. I was turning 40, and the heavens seen my weeping. He was telling me, you are haughty. You have to have a way. And I was looking at myself, why are they asking me a way? And you know, when you speak about something like that to your wife, and she looks at me, she says, I don't like your will now. Because people, when you like your will, what do you think about? You think about what is happening after. Because you might be gone, and what do you say about what happened? It's not bad to say right away. I'm not saying it here, I'm not taking it as a negative example. I'm just showing you that I was 40 and they were reminding me very well. Now, this Abraham is almost a type of that age. He doesn't have to write away the words you can pin on anything. And all my goods went to Lot, my nephew, because I don't have a child. I will be gone, my wife will go with me, and everything that is in my possession, that is mine, will be given to you. And God says, leave him now. But leave to go away. God must start to speak to him. He says, this is the first promise. God starts to promise Abraham something. He says, I will make you a great nation. He's actually talking about increase. He says, Abraham, you are actually yourself, your wife, your nephew and your servant, but I'm going to multiply you to become a great nation. I'm going to increase you. I'm going to para you, and after para you, I will rubber you, and after rubber you, I will mala you. God is promising Abraham to say, my will is that you become a great nation. Now, the first great year, it's about the number. God is saying, I'm going to make you much more than what you are. Because there are two greats. Remember, and then the second great says, I will make your name great. The second great is not about number. The second great, it's about influence. Hallelujah. The word in Hebrew actually is the word that says in English, a proud thing. I will make your name to become a proud thing. Whatever your name shall be mentioned, people will be proud of you. Hallelujah. There are surnames in this country. There are surnames in this country. When you mention that surname, people are proud of you. When you say, I'm from this family, I'm from that family, people are proud. Why? Because your name is a proud thing. But there are some names your enemies get messy because they are not great. They might be well known, but they are known in a bad way. Hallelujah. And this is not the legacy that I want to give to my kids. This should not be a legacy that I want to leave to the generation after you. You have to work that God doesn't only increase you in number, but God increases you also in influence. That God gives you a name that becomes great. That you might go somewhere and you say, I am the son of this man of God. And they say, yeah, you can come in. We don't know you, but we know that man of God. There are places where I've got access only because I've mentioned a name. That name can be Rema. That name can be Pastor Rema. That name can be Pastor Anthony. Because somebody with a name and the name has been great, that God has already increased in influence, can give you access to places. Hallelujah. And the greater name that you shall grow on is the name of God, Yahweh. Yahweh shall be your name, is the name of God. And the name of God is so great already that if you use that name, not misusing it, but using it in a way that you say to God, I am the child of God. I'm the child of Yahweh. My father is Yahweh. And then you can get access. Abraham, by that time he's still Abraham, I will make you a great nation. I will increase you. I will multiply you. And then I will fill the earth that I'll give you. The land that I promised to give you will never remain empty because I will not only increase you, multiply you, and then you will fill the place. He says, and I will bless you. You know, next Sunday, in the next two Sundays, I'll speak to you about the domains of increase, the domains of enlargement. And Abraham has already believed the three domains, or four of them. God will increase you physically, To the point that Abraham, at 75 years old, God will still give him a child. God will increase you spiritually. That the first I will bless you. The first I will bless you with the blessing of giving you things. The first blessing here is a blessing of God giving you a word. To bless here is to speak favor upon somebody. God says, I will speak favors upon you. I will speak favors upon you. When he speaks, it is happening. Remember, we sent here today again. Our second Sunday was, because you have said it, you will do it and I believe it. Because you have said it, it is done. When God speaks, he takes the responsibility of doing it. When he speaks, he comes to make sure that the thing comes to pass. Because he had a unique said, I am not a man to lie, not a son of man to repent. What I've said, can I not even want to break it happen or fulfill? Because God is not the son of man. He is not the son of man of a grace. I've heard you repeat it again, but I'll tell you this, God is not the son of man. A son of man can come and say, wow, I promised you the whole earth. But today we can divorce. The same way that God loves you, moves up and down. He loves you more than himself. One day we divorce. Hallelujah. Because the son of man can repent. But God is not the son of man to repent. Everything that he said about you for you, he is able to make it happen. The first blessing is the flavor. Then favor God. Then if he continues to say, I will make your name great, then he said, and you will be a blessing. In the other version, it says, you will be seen as a blessed person. Not only that I will speak blessing upon you, but I will make those blessings to be seen by people. That every time that somebody sees you, says, this one is blessed. Hallelujah. Now, this is now the material and financial blessing, the material and financial increases. God will increase us physically, spiritually, materially, and financially, but also increase us in influence. That's why he gives you a great name. A name that becomes by itself already a key for people to go and continue to go. Hallelujah. I will bless those who bless you. And whoever curses you, I will curse. God doesn't send you to curse anybody. But he says, anybody who curses you, leave him to God. God himself will curse. God said with your mouth, bless. Bless even the ones who hate you. Bless even your enemy. But God says, myself, I will take care of those who hate you. I will take care of those who curse you. Because God says, I will bless them myself. That's why you should not curse a child of God. Don't curse me. Because you are creating problems to your own life. I won't curse you back. But God will curse you. And if God curses you, who will bless you? Because the only person who can outdo a curse should be higher than the one who curses. That's a principle. Hallelujah. When Isaac blessed already Isaac, he blessed by saying, I'm giving all the blessing already. Now, when Esau came and said, Father, no, I'm here. They said, no, I've already blessed you. He said, no, it was not me, it was my son, my brother. He stole my blessing. Can you bless me and curse him now? The father said, I've already blessed him. I cannot change it. The only thing I can do, I will declare some blessings on you. You shall use the great, but you will always be a servant of your God. Hallelujah. There are principles in blessing. And God is the blesser. Even when I declare that I bless you as your spiritual father, God has to take that word and apply it in your life. And God looks at the, how can I say it? at the feasibility, or if you created the environment that will make God bless you, that's what I want to say. If you prepare the place, I will show you that God, when he multiplies you, before he reaches the multiplication, he prepares the place for multiplication. I was giving a talk in one of our clinics on Friday. It was in a meeting in the morning. I was talking to the clinical, the community healthcare workers. Usually in that clinic when I arrive, and they want us to have a meeting, it's usually about them wanting me to share with them the word of God. Then we were talking. We spoke about the word, and then we started speaking about the word of God. One of them asked me a question. And the question was like, let me not go there. But the point was, she wanted to have another child. She has already two children, and she's struggling to take care of the teacher. Now, I was asking a question. Do you think, because she was saying, God, the children are blessing from God? I said, yes, it's fine, it's okay. But do you think that God will bless you for you to have sorrows about it? Because now, because the child is a blessing, you decide to have a third one, and you still have not had a space to have the two ones. And the first one cannot even go be school properly because you are never going to do things for me. Then I said, no. One thing that I do, when God blessed the men and men and said, free me up, he already prepared Eden for them. Eden was there. I was just trying to explain to you, don't take any verse of the Bible out of the context to explain your own flaw, your own downfall. Yeah. If you tell me that God says, multiply, fill the earth, I will tell you God created already Eden. There was a place for them to have children. There was everything they needed to have. I was talking to them about wisdom. In this year of increase, we all need wisdom. That's why I'll continue to share with you. Every morning, verses about wisdom in Proverbs. Hallelujah. He says, I will bless those who bless you. And whoever blesses you, I will bless you. Listen to the last sentence. And all the people on the earth will be blessed through you. It means, I will use your name in the blessings. When people will be talking about blessings, they will never talk about blessings without mentioning Abraham. That's why when you read your Bible, and every time that God wanted to mention himself, other people to show them how he can bless them, he introduced himself as our blessing, as God of Abraham, God of Isaac, and God of Jacob. Read your Bible. Abraham was very rich. Isaac became very, very rich, to the point that the people knew him. Jacob was also very rich. I want to open a bracket to tell you. Isaac and Jacob were not very rich because their father was very rich. It was not only an inheritance, but you will see that Isaac went hard. He actually sowed and reaped. You will see that Jacob worked hard 7 years times two for him to get everything that he got. To the point that when Esau was coming to attack him, he would prepare a big present for him and say, brother, take all those things. And then Esau looked at this, but this is too much. Why do you want to give it to me? Because I have enough. Jacob told him also, brother, take it. Because me too, I have enough. But he worked for it. You will not sit there and say, my father is already rich. Rich, he has already prepared everything for me. I'll get it. It's food. But you have to work for that. I encourage all the fathers who are here. Your children are heirs of what you have, but you must make sure that you don't leave your heritage to children who are not ready to work unless, because they will spend everything. You have to show them that you work hard to get what you have, and they have also to work hard to keep it and sustain it. Hallelujah. Hard work gets you to possess, but hard work gets also to sustain what you have already. Am I talking to someone? Hallelujah. God has promised to enlarge us. Even if it took long or it takes long, or sometimes it appears like God didn't say that. Because imagine Abraham arrived in Canaan. And when they arrived in Canaan, at one stage, they were drought in Canaan. That he decided to bring Canaan going to Egypt. Because now God said, go to the land that I will show you and I will bless you there. But now there is a situation where the blessing that God spoke is not yet materialized. Remember, I told you there is the first blessing that is spiritual, and there is a second blessing that becomes material. Now, after that, God has already spoken to you. There is a process in which you should go to make the blessings of God become material. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, that you have been blessed from all the blessings in heaven. But sometimes it happens that you don't even have a 10 rand, a 1,000 rand. But you don't attach your blessings on heaven or not heaven. The blessings here, it's now filled with speaking of God about favor to one another. You have been blessed. I'm saying you have been blessed. I'm saying you have been blessed. I repeat, you have been blessed. I'm not saying you will be blessed. I'm saying you have been blessed. Abraham was blessed, but he arrived on the land where God wanted him. But on that land, there was trouble. Sometimes it appears that you live the opposite of what God told you. But as long as you know that you are at the right address where God wants you to be, remain there. I say remain there. I repeat, I say remain there. God says, God, you are alive there. Nothing is happening. And you look, you start me now. I heard God speak to you. Yes, God spoke to you. Stay there. It's God who spoke to you. Stay there. Hallelujah. Because it takes faith for you to receive the blessing of God. It takes faith for you to see those blessings become material. Abraham knew that he was at the right place. No, let me correct this. He knew that he was at the right place, but unfortunately, at one stage, he accepted to leave from what he sees and not from what he believes. He went to Egypt. But in Egypt, circumstances happened to the point that Abraham had to go back again to the place where God wanted him. But he left that place with blessings, with gifts from them. Hallelujah. Circumstances will work for your good. The Bible says God works for the good of those who love him. When he is only calling people to God, even if things are not working in God, stay there. I say stay there. I repeat, stay there. Because God is able to take you to the place of your blessing, or to bring your blessing to the place where you are, or God is able to materialize the blessing where you are. One thing remains: have faith unto him, because he spoke to you. Unless he never spoke, but if he spoke to you, have faith on him. I've given you so many of my testimonies. When I got married, I was a student. My father told me it's impossible for you to get married to see the student. You don't have a pastor, you don't even paint. How will you want to entertain a wife in the house? But I told him, God has spoken to him. The God of my covenant, whose name is Jehovah Financial, told me we take care of you. There were days when you wake up in the morning, you don't get a cent. I'm saying cent. You might get 20 cents, you might get 10 cents, but I don't get even a single 1 cent. And you wake up, you have a woman in bed who is pregnant, she just started pregnant. You have some food at home, and she's not eating that food because the taste has changed. She wants something that will cost you $2 or $3. You don't have it. Hallelujah. Brother Emmanuel, that is the time when you know if God has spoken to you as well. That is the time when you grow. In my heart, I'm just proud of God for you as well. I know. And because I knew that I was at the right place, God was always intervening. I told you how money appeared in our house. Not once, twice. Money appeared in there. And I've never preached it to make it a doctrine. But I know what God is able to do whatever he wants. Money appearing in the house. I'm saying money appearing in the house. Hallelujah. Pastor, how can it be? Yes. There was a time when Jesus needed to have money to pay for what? To pay taxes. And they didn't have money. Check it. Judas says there's no money in our account. Peter, go quickly to the river. Go and just go and fish. And the first fish that Peter opened the mouth, what was it? Where did that money come from? Not any bank can even tell you that they have the trace of that money. But God is able to create. I believe in God who is able to give you food in the wilderness when there is no bakery, but the heavenly bakery can send you manna. I believe in a God who is able to create from where you are, whatever you need, if you remain at the address where you want to be. He is the beggar. My friend Pastor Michel Ndagano preached, is one of his sermons. He says, God is the beggar. The beggar produces bread, and bread is what is necessary for you. Everything that you need, that is necessary for you. God says what? I am the beggar in heaven, and I'm able to bring it to you. When it arrives to you, we call it manna. Because manna in Hebrew means manhood. What is it? The God of surprise, the God of what is it, is the one who will increase you this year. Believe you me that he is in the business of preparing for you, what you need so that it will come to you and you receive it. In the morning there is manna. In the evening there is manna. You come morning again there is manna. Finish it. Because there is another manna coming to you in the evening. I'm speaking about the God of increase, the God of my covenant, the God of this church. The God of Pastor Raymond Crowley. The first church, Redemption Church, led by Pastor Joshua Macro, first church in South Africa that has been allowed to have a church built in a mall grade A. It is in Raymond. Because malls are commercial places. And Moors are not all my Christians. Muslims are dead. Hindi are dead. People of every and everyone's religion. But last year, Redemption has got a place in the modern Edenville, in a great M world, a big world. When you enter in the world, the first thing you see, Redemption Church, Redemption Church. The God of Rehoboam, our Father, is able to make us enter in the place where the word or the politics of this world would say it's closed for you. Because God can open doors. The God of increase will open door where there is no door for you. The God of increase will give a contract where they say you cannot sign another contract. In the same year, your contract will be changed 3 times, 7 times, 8 times, because your salary will be augmented every time. I say the God of increase will increase you. I say will increase you. I say will increase you. Will increase you. The blessing of God is in all our lives. Our house, then we release it out of our heart. Abraham was blessed. I want to repeat it again. People of God, we have the seed of enlargement in us. Because we have received the word of God and we are a good God. Even if it's not yet multiplied, right where you are. Jesus said it's multiplied 30 times, 60 times, 100 times. The multiple are handled. Let the word of God just find a heart that is ready to receive it. Are you here with me? God wants you today and this year to be a good crowd. A good crowd. That's why. That's why he said to Abraham, number one, before you get to me, you get the increase that I want to give you. Separate yourself from your heart, the heart of your father, from your family, and go where I want to take you. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. It says, therefore, come out from there and be separate, said the Lord. Touch no unclean, and I will receive you. In the Amplified Version, it says, and I will graciously receive you. I will graciously receive you, and I will welcome you with my favors. God says, you want me to receive you. You want me to get you in my favor. You want me to multiply you, to give you the grace of increase. Number one, come out from them, from their unbelievers. Separate yourself from them. Touch no unclean. Key number one for us to believe the increase of God is sanctification. I say sanctification, separation. We should not live among them. We are among them without being with them. Hallelujah. We should not adopt the culture of our family. We should not adopt the tradition of our tribe. You know, in our tribe, we are Xhosa, we are Zulu, we are Tswana, we are Maluba, we do this like that. We are now in the culture of the kingdom of God. The thing that shall be leading you in life, it's no more any other confusion besides this, the word of God. If the word of God never said it, you shall not do it. You do what is written here. No tradition. There are still a lot of Christians in the church. You're in the church believing in God and you still believe in your sisters. Their sisters say, their sisters do, their sisters this, their sisters that. People of God, you must separate yourself from them. Their sisters are gone. They are dead. They cannot dictate your life anymore. The only one who's alive, never been dead, or if was dead, remember that is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I insist again, stop with the tradition. Stop with the tradition. Separate yourself. Live the life of the child of God. Our culture, heaven. Now we are from Kasai. My husband, his name is Lukusa. You see, this name is from there. Hallelujah. You know, as in the north of Cameroon there, we do it like this. It's not our problem. No, Cameroon or not, you are no more. No more. No more among them. You might be with them. You might be from them. But God says you are with you. You are now from there. Look at the things of waiting. Colossians chapter 1, I think verse 21 says, now that you are from, you are in Christ, love the things of above. You set yourself, you set your eyes, you set your standard on the things of above. We want increase, yes, increase will come. But number one, sanctification. Number one, separate yourself from your family's behavior and your family culture. I'm not saying you should leave your family. Don't get me wrong. As a child of God, you shall be a family person. I'm not saying you must look at your family like they become now dead. No. I'm saying whatever is done in my family, that is not written in the word of God. I'm not touching. Because God says, touch no unclean thing. Everything that is unclean of knowledge. Hallelujah. I raise my right hand to say, God says, number one, sanctification. That's no unclean. And he said, I will receive and I will be a father to you, and you'll be my sons and daughters, said the Lord Almighty. When you become, God becomes your father and my son, you know what is happening in you? You have the same thing in him. Yes. The God of extension, the God of increase, the God of enlargement says, you become like me. The way I increase, you must do to increase. The way I multiply, you to multiply. The way I fill up, you to fill up. Because I am the one, and you are my sons and daughters. Can I have a bigger man?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Listen to me. The promise was for his children from the beginning. The children of God. Remember Genesis chapter 1? But because of the sin, we've been taken out of Eden, the place of enlargement. We found ourselves, our room became useful. But Jesus came back to work to restore the enlargement. Jesus came to restore us in our position of enlargement. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. Jesus came to restore us. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. The Bible says, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. The Bible says there will be no end on the increase of the government of Jesus and the peace of Jesus upon the throne of David and over his kingdom. This was a prophecy given by God to Israel through prophet Isaiah to say Jesus is coming and his increase will have no end. He will increase in 2021. He will increase in 2022. He will increase again in 2023. Until he comes back, his government will increase. Talking about government, he talks about the authority and the power of Jesus Christ. And he says, and peace shall also increase. The word peace here is the word shalom. Shalom in Hebrew means number one, peace. Number two, nothing will miss, nothing shall be broken. When the peace of God is in you, God says, I will not let anything be broken in you. I will not let anything miss me. Number three, the word shalom means warfare. You know, a warfare, when we speak about warfare, we are actually saying that we will have a well-being. And that contains good health, prosperity, rest, peace, and also safety. When somebody says, talks to me about warfare, he's saying it's a state in which you find yourself in good health, perfect health, but also you are prospering, you are getting your things increasing, but also you rest, you are in peace, that you know nothing will shake you. Why? Because you live in safety. This is shalom, the shalom that when I wish you shalom, I say shalom as a greeting, I'm saying to you, let the peace of God be with you. Meaning that nothing shall miss in your life, nothing shall be broken. You will live in good health, you will prosper, you will live in rest and safety in a company. That's why it is written in Peter chapter 2, chapter 1, verse 2. It says, I pray, and I like it in easy version. It says, beloved, I pray that all may go well with you. That all may go well with you. This is the peace. And it says, and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. You have to make your soul, have your soul saved by God, sanctified, walking with me. When you let your soul be prospering, you're gonna see everything. speaking also from God. Hallelujah. Don't let yourself be affected by nothing. You just leave the church on Sunday and you say, no, I'm not going back to that church. You know that pastor when he was preaching, he was talking about me. How on the earth I will take all my time to come here, sit there, worshiping with the team here, finishing my worship, coming out here, taking a mic, and come to preach the word of God just for me to target you? Hallelujah. And come every day I have a problem with your coming to speak to you. I want to waste my time to take this holy mic. Hallelujah. Keep your soul. I feel that these people don't love me. Who told you that they don't love me?
We love you, dear. We love you.
Now, I've been in that church, they never spoke about me.
No, we can speak about you.
Who wants me to speak about you?
I'll speak about you.
Brother Fred, you want me to speak about you?
I've seen your head.
Brother Fred, if you come like that, you see, Brother Fred is an accountant, he's a chartered accountant. This man has all the papers, he's legal in South Africa. He's a South African man. If you have your books, you want your books to be checked, go to Brother Fred. Pay him the invoice that will give you. It's one me from my heart. Brother Fred is a good man. You see that? Give him a hand of applause. Franz, you want me to talk about him? Stand up with him. Franz Olebole. Franz Olebole. How are you, Franz? Good man, this man. Last Sunday after service, he came to me to tell the pastor, actually, there's a lot of guys outside, I want to pack it. Yeah. Then I said, our machine is a problem. No, he says, I have my own machine. When I was doing this job, I did my this job, I bought the machine. On Monday and Tuesday, came to that office. It's outside there. All the guys are stuck to the outside. It's him. Thank you. This is a good man. Now, the same day, on Monday evening, I came here to see him when he finished the prayer around 5. And he was saying, Pastor, you know I'm blessed. When I was cutting here, somebody here on number 19, he saw me cutting. He says, when you finish here, come also to cut at my place. Listen to me. When he said, yesterday you preached, you said, this is the year of increase. I believe this is the year of increase. Yes! This is the year of increase. You're going to get more business in Jesus' name. And you never ask for money.
Wow.
It's on machine, it's on time. It came on Monday 8 to 5. On Tuesday 8 to 1, then went to the job that came. I took him a video of him. I told him I will post you on Facebook. I'll tell everybody, if you need someone who can dress up in your life, come find me, transfer your name. I'll give you his number. If you want to, if you want somebody to catch dress, I'll give his number. Madam, you can do that again. Hallelujah! Can you meet God ahead of our food? The shadow, it is well, and it will be well. Your business will prosper. Nothing will stop you to go ahead. I declare that it is well with you. It's gonna be well. The Shunammite lady, she got a baby. The story is in 2 Kings chapter 4. And after some time, the Bible says the child was at the feet of the father. The child was for the head. Headache, the father said, come to your mother. She went to the child, went to the mother. What was with the mother? The child died. And the mother, before even she cried, she remembered that this child, they got this blessing from a man of God, Prophet Elisha. And Prophet Elisha was something. He called one of his servants. He said, "Servant, prepare a king. Let him charge. Don't tell your heart. We're going to see the man of God." Hallelujah. Listen to me. I'm going to give you a beautiful, wise advice. This woman knew that the increase in the family came from God. When things were not going well at all, and she started to lose the increase, where did he go? She never got to the ancestors. She went back to God. Without speaking to the husband, without crying because she needed to be wise. And the Bible says, she said, "It is well." When she arrived and the prophet saw her, the prophet asked three questions. Is it well with your husband? Is it well with you? Is it well with your son? What was the answer? 2 Kings chapter 4:6. The woman says, "It is well." Men of God, it is well. Listen to me. In this year of increase, it might happen that you are losing what God has given you. Go back to God. When you go back to God, speak the word of God. Don't speak anything else, but speak the peace of God. Say, "God, I know that your blessing shall never be followed by sorrow. And the sorrow that I want and the devil want to give me, I refuse to receive it. I say it is well with me. It shall be well with me. It remains well with me. It will go away well." And speak it. That's why every month, at the beginning of the year, the man is going to spend 3 days fasting and praying, going back to God to say, "We know it is well. We proclaim again your peace with this man. We know it is well. The increase is coming again. We know it is well. No matter what, from 1st February to 3rd February, I invite you to find a place where you shall fast and pray with us so that you say, 'God, I know it is well.' The increase shall come. And if it will fail, to come. To be followed next time. God bless you." Let's close our eyes and pray. It is God's promise that we will increase. It is God's promise that you will increase. But remember, there might be circumstances that speak to you and tell you, "No, this is not God's will." Abraham was still in Canaan, but the land became dry. I don't know, maybe you're in that situation where you look around you and you say, "There is no way I will increase this year. There is no way I will enlarge this year. There is no way I will go further this year. Because I've done everything last year. It never works." But I want to tell you, number one, sanctification. Number two, go back to God, the one who gives increase every time there is challenge. Can you speak to him now? I said, "God, here I am, I want to speak to you. God, here I am, I want to speak to you. I know things appear to be difficult. The challenges are too many for myself." When you look your head, you say, "Yes, pattern. Wow, challenges are there. But can you speak peace now? It is well, it is well, it is well. It is well, it is well. It is well." God, if in the beginning of this year, you could pay off the debt of person, 21,000 debt, you can do it for my mother and my sister. There are people in debt here, and who are actually crossed, swimming in debt. Peace is gone because they couldn't pay in December. And January started. The debtors behind them, I pray for your peace. 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 Nothing missing, nothing broken. I pray for one of them. I pray that the one thing will be with them. Good health, prosperity, safety, increase, and rest in Jesus' mighty name. Pray. Speak to him. Mandala. To God, go back to God. Come out of them. Say, I cannot live like them, I cannot do like them. Yes, I'm a young boy like them, I'm a young girl like them, but I cannot live like them. I refuse to live like them. I refuse to conform to this world. I refuse to walk the way they walk. Sanctification is the first key. If you're in this place and you never give your heart to Jesus, Jesus is not your Lord and Savior yet. You have never given your heart to Jesus. Increase is not your portion. You shall first start by giving your heart to me. Where you are, can you just raise your hand? I will see you. I'll pray for you. I'll pray with you. If that is you, and you say, Pastor, help me. I want to first become a child of God. I want to give my heart to God. Because if Jesus comes back today, I will go to hell. Heaven is not my portion. Where you are, lift up your hand. I will pray. Lift up your hands. Don't be ashamed. Our eyes are closed. But I see your hand there. Our eyes are closed. Sister, I see your hand. I see your hand, my sister. I see your hand, my brother. Where you are, can you just stand up where you are? I'm going to pray for you. Stand up where you are, please. They want to raise their hands. You want to keep their hands. They want to keep Jesus. Pray after me, say, Jesus. I invite you, my love. I want you to be my Savior, to be my Lord. I want to walk with you from now. I have heard your words. You are a God of increase. You want to increase me, but I need you to come out from the world and walk with you. Separate from the world and be attached to you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray for these brethren. These four gentlemen and these two ladies who are out now giving their life to Jesus Christ to you. I pray in Jesus' mighty name that you change their lives, that you make them new, that they walk and they receive the blessing of heaven. Favors from you to walk and fear in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Give him a hand of applause.
Hallelujah. God bless you. We'll continue with the teaching next Sunday. I will finish what I wanted to tell you. We'll continue on next Sunday. We're still building on now. On the vision for the year. The next 3 Sundays, I'm still talking and bringing the foundation of this vision. The last Sunday of the month, I won't be here. I'll be preaching in another church somewhere. I've been invited. And Pastor Solomon will be here on the 30th to continue. We're talking about the enlargement. And the first Sunday of February, don't miss that service. It's our Vision Sunday. First Sunday of February, it's our Vision Sunday. It's actually counts as our annual general meeting because we're a church, and the church we are registered as a non-profit organization, and it's important for us to have a Sunday where we present to you the vision of the church, but also the budget. And you, as members of the church, you vote with us that budget to say we are okay with this budget of 26 million rand. We're going to make sure that we give the 26 million rand, we take them together by the defense. Hallelujah. That will be for first time.